So I'm at Heythrop 2017 graduation. I've just completed my MA in philosophy and religion. I did that part-time. I did my undergraduate at Heythrop, so Heythrop's been a real kind of part of my adult journey.
Yeah, so this is Heythrop's very last graduation ever, as it is closing as an institution.
A sad loss to the University of London and to academia in general.
I started this college maybe 3 or 4 years ago, doing PRE, Philosophy, Religion and Ethics. It's been a long journey for a lot of students, and it's been a challenge, but it's a subject that I've been quite passionate about until now, even finishing graduation and starting to work, you know, meeting so many lifelong friends. And I think I've grown and developed as a person so much, and it's just an overwhelming experience, I think.
It's a very special occasion for me because it's actually my first master's degree graduation, and also because, from what I've heard, it's going to be the last graduation ceremony here.
I have achieved a first class degree in philosophy, and I am very, very proud that I have gotten here today, really.
When you have worked so hard and then it's coming to an end, however, it's the beginning of another phase in my life.
We both had a fantastic time and hopefully given huge moments of reflection and thought.
I hope it's going to be a great experience for everyone. Certainly Heythrop has been a great experience for me. I have many fond memories.
A great place to learn, develop, not just academically, but as a person. So I have a lot of friends here, both fellow students and staff and colleagues, and that's a great thing about Heythrop, is it was a real community. Very unique in that you get to know everyone, and everyone's is there supporting you in a number of ways. And it was a great place to get involved, a great place to really develop and establish your own ideas. And so this master's was a real personal decision to take my learning and myself as a person, you know, onto that next step, that next level.
Been given a new responsibility, and I think all I've gathered from Heythrop College, so it was a wonderful time, a wonderful experience at Heythrop College. And coming here makes me happy with my friends and my classmates and my family coming to celebrate with me.
It's absolutely wonderful to see all my friends and loved ones that I've come to know across the last 3 years brought together to really just hone in on what it is that we've all been able to achieve.
And I had an absolutely fantastic time at Heythrop. I learned so much. I learned particularly a great deal about Islam, which has been incredibly helpful to me in understanding the world we're now living in. I learned a great deal about Judaism, my own religion. And I'm very sad that this will be one of the last graduations. I think it's a great loss to the nation that Heythrop College is closing.
It definitely was a memorable time that I had with Heythrop.
Yeah, it's very bizarre. I mean, Heathrop's always been a great, close-knit, family-like community, and it's really quite sad to see it go.
I really enjoyed learning here. It was a chance for me to explore my subject as a teacher, and my tuition was fantastic, and I'll be really sad to see this come to an end.
I wish the students here all the best, and I do wish that we'll be together in the future for whatever reason, you know, that there be job opportunities or just hanging out.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, it is my pleasure on behalf of my colleagues, the governors and staff of Heythrop College, to welcome you, our graduating students, members of your families and your friends, to our celebration this afternoon. I would like to extend an especially warm welcome to Professor Sir Adrian Smith, Vice-Chancellor of the University, who I invite to speak to us now.
Principal, distinguished guests, graduands, ladies and gentlemen. As the Vice-Chancellor of the University of London, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to join us in today's celebration of achievement and success. As many of you will know, the University of London is a federation of 18 of the most distinguished research and specialist higher education institutions in London, and the University is proud to have Heythrop as one of its members. In addition to the excellence and eminence of the member institutions, the Central University itself contributes to our collective national and international standing through the School of Advanced Study, the Senate House Libraries, and the International Academy. The volume of our activity in the family of University of London is quite staggering. In addition to the 130,000 students at the member institutions physically here in London, there are a further 52,000 in 180 countries studying around the world for University of London degrees. And for a further perspective on the scale of our activity, next time you are in Bloomsbury and pass our Senate House building, glance up at the tower and reflect on the mind-boggling fact that the building contains 4 million books, 70,000 journal titles, and 12 million historical materials relating to the arts, humanities, and social sciences. Collectively, our university is a national and international force to be reckoned with, and I hope that the association of membership of the Federation gives you added pleasure, all of you graduating today. Everyone is aware that there have been major changes to the way that public money is being channeled into higher education, increasingly through students in the form of fees rather than direct grants through the Higher Education Funding Council. And before taking up my role as Vice-Chancellor, I spent 4 years in Whitehall as a civil servant, overseeing the policy and budgets for higher education. I'm therefore as aware as anyone of the threats and the uncertainties that the new regime brings. And now added to that, we have Brexit and a maverick US president. So there's a time of great uncertainty for all of us. But at a time when national political and media preoccupation is quite naturally and properly focused on the economy and social issues, it's ever more important that we all argue for and celebrate the importance of higher education, of learning, of scholarship. Of course, higher education does contribute directly to the economy and society through graduates with high-level skills, underpinning business and industry, manufacturing, life sciences, creative industries. But civilized society also requires critical intelligence that questions and challenges the status quo. Wider issues of sustainability, the environment, social and global justice and security require constant intellectual and ethical challenge, and that is provided in the future by our brightest and best graduates across a wide range of disciplines, very much including those studied at Heythrop. These major societal challenges involve a complex mix of technical, human behavioral, and societal understanding. Just reflect for a moment on those major challenges. Living with environmental change, climate change, aging and well-being, global security, sustainable energy, impact of the digital economy on all of us, food and water security for the future. Clearly, meeting these challenges requires an understanding of individual behavior and cannot be viewed or addressed solely as technological issues. We also live in an increasingly diverse society, which in turn presents increasing human challenges in understanding and tolerating diversity at both individual and group level. And one of the great virtues of higher education is that it provides both an intellectual and a living community experience that contributes significantly to that required tolerance and understanding, and helped shape the ethical lives of the next generation of leaders. And in this respect, you will all know well that Heythrop excels. So this is a special occasion. Special, of course, for those of you graduating. It marks the end of an important phase of your lives and celebrates your achievements. But special too for all your families and friends who've shared with you and supported you on this journey to this point. So my congratulations on behalf of everyone in the University of London to all of you whose achievements are being recognised and honoured today. You should be very proud. We are very proud of you.
I call upon Professor Claire Ozan, Principal of Heythrop, to address the audience.
I will begin by congratulating you, our graduating students, on your achievements, which we are very proud to celebrate with you today. Whether you've just completed your undergraduate degree, your master's, or your doctoral studies, you will have worked very hard indeed to get to this point. Those of you who've been part-time students have had to balance your commitments to study with your responsibilities at work, in ministry, or in the family. Those of you who've completed a full-time course have often combined your studies with a job and with internships to position yourselves well in the employment market. There will have been moments, I'm sure, when you may have felt like giving up, but you have fought through and worked really hard to reach this point. You should all be very proud of what you have achieved. This dedication will put you in good stead for the future. Many of you will not have achieved this all by yourself. You will have had support from family, partners, and friends. And today is a moment for us to extend our thanks to them too. It is the sincere hope of all of us at Heythrop that you have benefited from our community of learning. We hope that you have caught something of our passionate belief in the value of the subjects we teach for individuals and wider society. A couple of years ago, a career survey told us almost two-thirds of our leavers pursue further study or enter or return to the people professions, teaching, ministry, healthcare, social care, and third sector charity work. This is a good record for a college such as ours. But whatever you choose to do next, it is altogether likely that because of your studies here, you will bring to your work a creative, critical, and reflective mind, and that generosity of spirit of which our mission statement speaks. The words that John Henry Newman used in his discourse on the idea of a university in 1852 might well be spoken of by any advocate of such a university education today. If then a practical end must be assigned to a university course, I say it is that of training good members of society. It is the education which gives someone a clear, conscious view of their own opinions and judgments, a truth in developing them, an eloquence in expressing them, and a force in urging them. Heythrop's mission is underpinned by our commitment to the ideals of Jesuit education, the care of the person, and a personal approach to learning, and is possible in part because the Society of Jesus has so generously resourced us. Even more so, it is made possible by the generous service offered routinely by our academic and support staff who embody Heythrop's Jesuit vision. And today I would like to thank them all on your behalf for the great many hours that they have given to make this remarkable personal education available to you, an education of high quality. The importance and quality of what we offer is demonstrated by the results of the 2017 National Student Survey, which measures student satisfaction, and in which we were ranked fourth in the University of London, and is further underlined by the many comments we receive from our former students. Here are a couple of headlines. Heythrop has an inspiring vision of deeply rooted openness. The standard of the theology department is second to none. The value of Heythrop is inestimable. The staff and students of Heythrop have made an enormous contribution to the intellectual life and the life of the church in this country in a number of ways. Through the distinctive way in which we bring theology into dialogue with philosophy and philosophy into dialogue with theology. Through the provision of ministerial training in a university context. And through the resources we provide from the Catholic tradition for those of other Christian denominations, of other faiths and of no faith, and the personal approach to education. It is with great sadness, therefore, that we have now moved into the final year of Heythrop College. The college was founded in 1614 in Louvain in Belgium by the Society of Jesus. Heythrop is the oldest college of the Federal University of London, which it joined as a constituent college in 1971, having been able to award University of London degrees since 1840. The college moved to Great Britain during the French Revolution. Its activities initially split between Stonyhurst in Lancashire and St Mino's in Denbighshire, North East Wales, before coming together in 1926 at Heythrop Hall in Oxfordshire. At this point, the college was also awarding degrees from the Jesuit Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome. Heythrop moved to London and then to Kensington in 1993. And in 2014, Heythrop College celebrated the 400th anniversary of its foundation. There is no doubt that the academic staff at Heythrop have made an extraordinary contribution to their disciplines and to society through their scholarship and public square work. In the last national research assessment exercise, the REF, 62% of research at Heythrop was rated internationally excellent or world leading. The quality of the impact of our research on society was particularly commended and was stronger than that in the University of Oxford's submission. Heythrop scholars have produced groundbreaking work. Copleston's History of Philosophy, Robert Murray's work on the Syriac Fathers, and Jack Marney's seminal work on the history of moral theology, for example. Since the year 2000, the turn of the millennium, staff at Heythrop have published more than 120 major monographs and well over 500 articles on topics ranging from analytic theology to Wittgenstein to the early councils of the church and liberation theology. Colleagues have contributed to debate in areas such as the epistles of St. Paul and the Book of Revelation, the spirituality of St. Teresa and St. John of the Cross, the image of Christianity in modern Islamic thought, religion, reason and science, ethics and psychoanalysis, religious pluralism and interreligious dialogue, anti-realism and expansive naturalism, Christ in the context of climate change, respect for the dignity of the vulnerable, and the value of toleration. Their research has had a significant impact outside the academic sphere in the development of interreligious engagement and of new forms of religious expression, and on the ethics of finance and business. We continue to support staff at Heythrop in this work during our last year and will celebrate these contributions in our final conference in July 2018. In the same period since the year 2000, over 1,700 undergraduates, 2,300 master's students and 75 doctoral students have graduated from Heythrop, joining the workforce and contributing to communities all over the UK and beyond. Following the announcement to close, we have very much appreciated the expressions of support received both in the press and by individuals. We continue to work with the Society of Jesus in planning how to continue its tradition of scholarship and engagement with higher education through the intellectual apostolate. We are truly grateful for the contributions you have made to the life of our college. Our student union has been greatly enriched by the time you have given to organise its many societies and clubs. Our work this year to ensure we offer you a high standard of service as the college winds down would not have been possible without the time you put in to focus groups and liaison committees. Along with the Heythrop staff and alumni, you now embody the legacy of the college, with its significant impact on the academy and on society worldwide. We strongly encourage you to keep in touch with us and with one another through the Heythrop Student and Staff Alumni Association as you move into the next phase of your life. I will conclude with some words from Pope Francis in his speech to the youth. Each son or daughter of a given country has a mission, a personal and social responsibility. I urge you then to go forward and take up your mission. Many congratulations and thank you. Vice-Chancellor, I beg leave to present the following graduands.
Graduands awarded the Bachelor of Arts in Abrahamic Religions. Alex Kader. Sachi Mahendran. Graduands awarded the Bachelor of Arts in Philosophy. Caleb Asirati, awarded First Class Honours. Rachel Atkinson, awarded First Class Honours. Dexter Bardua. Juliet Branfield. Fenner Clark, awarded First Class Honours. Henry Couture. Samuel Dalzell. Cassinda Delgado, awarded First Class Honours. Thomas Dempsey. Henry Edward Zhu. Daniel Fair. Noah Goodliff. Joshua Henshaw. Diana Ivanovich. Beth Ann Johnson, awarded First Class Honours. Matthew Keats. Megan Kendall. Jack Lane, awarded First Class Honours. Lucy Mulcahy. Liam Pinto. Richard Pullin. Chloe Rowbottom. Lauren Slater, awarded first class honours. Emily Webster. Hugo Whitmey, awarded first class honours. Oscar Ewell, awarded first class honours. Graduands awarded the Bachelor of Arts in Philosophy, Politics and Ethics. Marwia Ahmed. Stefan Barrett, awarded first class honours. Jean Elligott Furness. Rhiannon Jones. Daniel Turner. Benjamin Walker. Graduands awarded the Bachelor of Arts in Philosophy, Politics and Religion. Tipagaran Baskaran. Christina Lee. Graduands awarded the Bachelor of Arts in Philosophy, Religion and Ethics. Lucy Clay. Abigail Griffin. Natasha Hawley. Candice Henry. Nataza Kovacevic. Harry Lee. King Nam Lung. Sarah Morris. Louis Morel. Johanna Vanska. Matthew Webb. Gemma Wishart. Graduand awarded the Diploma of Higher Education in Philosophy, Religion and Ethics. Aisha Griffiths. Graduands awarded the Bachelor of Arts in Philosophy and Theology, Michael Bailey. Rosanna Kent. Israel Collade, awarded first class honours. Philip Mitchell. Hannah Murphy. Isabella Retka Grover. Thomas Scanlon. Philip Sivier, awarded first class honours. William Surridge. Louise Woods. Graduands awarded the Bachelor of Arts in Study of Religions, Gauri Hari Harbal. Sumaya Janat, awarded First Class Honours. Graduands awarded the Postgraduate Diploma of Higher Education in Study of Religions, Suna Riaz. Graduands awarded the Bachelor of Arts in Theology, Zara Almeray. Lily Bliss. Luke Hayes, awarded First Class Honours and the Marcus Ward Memorial Prize for the highest marks in New Testament. Monique Reichberger. Dudu Wang. Graduands awarded the Bachelor of Divinity, Michael O'Grady. Graduand awarded the Bachelor of Arts in Philosophy, Mandeep Jenny Digpal Kaur. Thank you. graduands awarded the Master of Arts in Abrahamic Religions, Peter Wright. Graduands awarded the Master of Arts in Biblical Studies, Christine Carpenter, awarded with distinction. Debbie Davis. Alison Fincham, awarded with distinction. Anne Fincher O'Brien. Valerie Nazareth. Olatunde Oyewole, awarded with distinction. Erica Roll. Usman Sheikh. Raphael Thurstons. Eamon Walls, awarded with distinction. Graduands awarded the postgraduate certificate. Julia Middleton. Graduands awarded the Master of Arts in Canon Law, Louis Appia. Mary Hawkey. Michael Panejo. Graduands awarded the Master of Arts in Christian Spirituality, Amy Pye. Angela Finnegan. Robert Flynn. Anne Milner. Master of Arts in Christian Theology, Anita Cobb, awarded with distinction. Jill Hopkinson. Abayomi Lijoka. Susan Nelligan. Ziba Norman. Aidan Smith. Christopher Stoll, awarded with distinction. Michael Sweeney, awarded with distinction. Angela Swindley. Graduands awarded the Master of Arts in Contemporary Ethics, Faith Anderson, awarded with distinction. Stephen Borton. Thomas Burke. Helen Cannons, awarded with distinction. Kezi Charles. Zofia Crowther. Anna Gavorin, awarded with distinction. Ben King. Daniela Mascarenas. Kathleen McGuffog. Kevin McNamara. Benedict Miller. Patricia Morris. Pietro Obertelli, awarded with distinction. Zinat Rahman. Rita Remis. Rodrigo Sanchez. Christopher Whitehouse. Hannah Woolley. Master of Arts in Pastoral Theology, Joan Conway. Edgerton Gabonda. Luke Goymore. Graduands awarded the Master of Arts in Philosophy, Emma Broadhurst. Edward Caddell, awarded with distinction. Heidi Cobham. Alan Glazier. Alexander Grimwood, awarded with distinction. Amelia Harrison. Luis Leal Carnero. Isabel Pallier. Nasir Rashid, awarded with distinction. Daniel Sandelson, awarded with distinction. Graduands awarded the Master of Arts in Philosophy and Religion, Agnes Chambers. Maximilian George Gavrilchuk. John Haderman, awarded with distinction. Matthew Holland. Mitch Law. Chloe Oliver. Graduands awarded the Master of Arts in Philosophy in Education, Porto de Almeida. Helen Kunda. Samantha Wilson. Graduands awarded the Master of Arts in Philosophy of Religion and Ethics in Education, Beverly Clark. Timothy Hunting, awarded with distinction. Jade Irving. Priscilla Osei. Megan Skingsley. Spencer Woods. Graduands awarded the Master of Arts in Psychology of Religion, Adrian Parkhouse. Graduands awarded the Master of Theology, Mark Aloysius, awarded with distinction. Luke Dominic Omway. Fiona O'Reilly, awarded with distinction. Leonard Tatt. Catherine Wallace Hughes, awarded with distinction. Graduands awarded the Master of Research in Pastoral Theology, Linda Fox. Graduands awarded the Master of Research in Philosophy, Philippa Springett. Almost a year ago, one of our students, Magali Nicole, very sadly died after a relatively short illness. For the study which Magali had completed before her death, she is being posthumously awarded a postgraduate diploma in philosophical studies, and we welcome her husband, Leon Morris, to receive the award on her behalf. Graduands awarded the Doctor of Philosophy with a thesis entitled A Theological Aesthetics of Liberation, God, Art, and the Social Outcasts, supervised by Dr. Michael Kerwin, Vicente Chong Sanchez. With a thesis entitled From Inevitability to Possibility, an interpretation of Augusto Del Noce's History of Modern Philosophy, supervised by Dr. Anthony Carroll and Dr. Peter Gallagher, Giorgio Durante. With a thesis entitled, Does the Use of Models of the Church Help in an Understanding of the Place of the Personal Ordinariate in the Contemporary Church, with specific reference to England and Wales? Supervised by Dr. Helen Costigan. Veronica Fulton. With a thesis entitled Facilitating Theological Conversations About the Holocaust, an Assessment of the Applicability of David Tracy's Notion of the Classic, supervised by Dr. Martin Poulsom, John Gravett. With a thesis entitled An Ethical Appeal to Experience Through the Practice of Deep Attentive Listening, Bridging the Disjunction Between Ecclesial Teaching and Practice, supervised by Dr. Anna Abram and Dr. Nicholas Austin, Liam Hayes.
Chancellor, Chair of Governors, Principal, colleagues, graduates and guests. It is my pleasure and privilege today to ask the Chair of Governors to admit Mr. Andrew Kennedy and Dr. James Sweeney as Honorary Fellows of Heythrop College. Andrew Kennedy first. Andrew is a lawyer. After graduating from Cambridge, he joined a commercial firm in the city as a corporate lawyer, later rising to the positions of partner and then senior partner. Over a period of about 13 years, he served on the Council of the Law Society and a number of its committees as an expert in the field of insurance. On retirement, he held various positions in public and private companies and charities, and became involved in the world of education as a governor in state and private schools, Digby Stewart College and Roehampton University, and he was also the first chair of the Merton Schools Forum. Andrew's services to education in Britain were recognised by Pope John Paul II by the award of a papal knighthood. Andrew had two spells as a governor of Heythrop, first from 2005 to 2014, then in 2015, in a time of crisis, he generously agreed to return as chair of governors and served in that capacity into 2016. As a governor, he played a very large part in the arrangements the college made with the Society of Jesus over the Kensington Square site, and later worked very hard for the preservation of the college when its long-term financial future needed further determination. Latterly, as chair of governors, Andrew guided Heythrop through a difficult period of transition when the decision was made to close the college. I can't claim to know Andrew well, but everyone I've spoken to agrees that his contribution to the life of the college over a period of 10 years has been outstanding, both in his expertise and in his unflagging, wholehearted commitment to the well-being of the students, the staff, and his fellow governors. Amply demonstrated by the energy and time he consistently put in to working on their behalf. I imagine that very many people in this room today share his regret that, in his own words, those who make the final decisions were unable to see a future for the college after 400 years of distinguished service to the life of the church and the wider world. Chair of Governors, I formally request you, on the authority of the governing body, to admit Mr. Andrew Kennedy as a Fellow of Heythrop College, University of London. Dr. James Sweeney is currently Provincial Superior of the Irish-Scottish Province of the Passionists, a Roman Catholic religious order of which he is a member. Jim's connections with Heythrop extend over many years. He was a theology student in the 1960s, he really is that old, when Heythrop was a Jesuit college in Oxfordshire. He also studied philosophy and theology in Dublin, before taking up social sciences with the Open University. Later, he was again at Heythrop, this time for a master's degree in pastoral theology here in London, before going on to complete a doctorate in sociology of religion, also in London University. In 1999, while he was senior research fellow at the von Hugel Institute in Cambridge, he became visiting lecturer and tutor at Heythrop in sociology of religion. Later, he worked as convener of the MA in pastoral studies and then head of the pastoral and social studies department. For 5 years, he was also director of the Heythrop Research Institute in the area of religion and society, and at different times served as acting principal, associate vice principal, and finally vice principal academic, before retiring in 2015. In all of this, we found in Jim a gifted and effective priest, teacher, researcher, writer, editor, and administrator, and a widely valued colleague and friend. One of Jim's distinguished contributions to academic life is the methodology of theological action research, which he developed with colleagues in the Action Research Church and Society project, which he founded. This approach, which has since been taken up by many people, brings together in a creative conversation the different elements of empirical research and theological investigation and reflection as a basis for practical action shaped for particular social and religious contexts. In this, Jim brought to Heythrop an outstanding example of what has been seen as one of the college's unique gifts: the desire and ability to combine and to teach others how to combine serious academic work in empirical research, philosophy, theology, and religion as a foundation for creative, appropriate, and effective ministry and action in the church and in the wider world. A gift which is sadly now about to be lost. Chair of Governors, I formally request you, on the authority of the governing body, to admit Reverend Dr. James Sweeney as a Fellow of Heythrop College, University of London.
Ladies and gentlemen, we now move to awarding the honorary degrees. I call upon Mr. Anthony O'Mahony.
Vice-Chancellor, colleagues, graduates, ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Bishop Antoine Audo, SJ. In the Syriac tradition, the term malfono is given for an honoured teacher. Malfono is someone whom by their knowledge and wisdom convey learning and at a profound level. Bishop Audo, as Malfano, has brought about through his scholarly work a deep and cultured conversation between the sacred and the temporal, as is proper between the secular and the holy in the world. Bishop Audo was a key figure at the Special Synod for the Eastern Catholic and Latin Bishops of the Middle East, which took place in Rome in October 2010. He made an explicit connection between the ending of the Synod for the Middle East's final declaration in September 2012 and Benedict XVI's papal visit to Lebanon and the so-called Arab Spring, which articulated a need for a political change in the region. Bishop Audo quotes the declaration, summing up the profound desire for a reordering and reorientation of religious thought towards a new understanding of the political in the context of religious freedom as a key theme in understanding conversion and mission. Religious tolerance exists in a number of countries, but it does not have effect since it remains limited in the field of action. There is a need to move beyond tolerance to religious freedom. Taking this step does not open the door to relativism, as some would maintain. It does not compromise belief, but rather calls for a reconsideration of the relationship between man, religion, and God. It is not an attack on the fundamental truths of belief, since despite human and religious differences, a ray of truth shines in all men and women. We know very well that truth apart from God does not exist as an autonomous reality. If it did, it would be an idol. Truth can only be known and experienced in freedom. For this reason, we cannot impose truth on others. Truth is disclosed only in the encounter of love. Father Antoine Audo, SJ, Chaldean Bishop of Aleppo, Syria, is a leading scholar, church leader of his community, and president of Caritas Syria, which has aided hundreds of thousands of people during a period of deeply challenging conflict, which has impacted upon not just the Middle Eastern region, but the wider world. He is a member of the Pontifical Council for Migrants and the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue at the Vatican. Born in Aleppo in 1946, he entered the Society of Jesus in 1969, ordained a priest in 1979. He commenced his academic formation with studies in Arabic language and culture at the University of Damascus in 1972. His doctoral thesis at the Sorbonne in 1979 on the leading Arab thinker of modernity and mysticism, Zaki al-Azuzi, published in Beirut in 1988. He completed his philosophical and theological formation with biblical studies at the Pontifical Biblical Institute. Bishop Odo has long been associated with the Eastern Christian apostolate of the Society of Jesus, especially in the Middle East and its educational endeavour. The Pontifical Oriental Institute, which was celebrated its 100th anniversary in 2017, and for the last decade with the Centre for Eastern Christianity at Heythrop College, the University of London. Ecumenical and interreligious dialogue had been central to his life and work. In his memorable lecture at the Centre for Eastern Christianity in June 2010, Eastern Christian Identity, a Catholic Perspective, he states, Eastern Christians can, with Muslim thinkers, reread the history of Arab philosophy, recognizing the rational and critical dimension. Through this work of spirit, to which many Christians have contributed, to recover its national and universal unity, which will help to free itself from fundamentalism and call to violence, leading to increasingly to death. We have in the history of the Chaldean Church and the Society of Jesus such eminent figures of the Arab Renaissance as Father Louis Sheko or Father Paul Naiwia. Walking in the footsteps of the 9th century Timothy III of the Church of the East, the Chaldean Catholic Church is the sister church of the Church of the East. In Timothy's exploration of the encounter with Islam, is increasingly seen as an archetype for global Christianity in Muslim-Christian relations. At the Asian Synod in 1998, when discussing relations between Christians and Muslims, Bishop Antoine set out his vision to survive and develop as living churches in the Arab and Muslim world of the Middle East. Christian Arabs or Asians need a spiritual vision of their relations with Islam, seeing themselves sent by Christ to witness to love. And that evangelization in these lands requires Christians to live within Islam, that is, from an integral part of society, of Arab and Muslim culture, without complexes. But at the same time, to be witness to the evangelicals' liberty in ways that go beyond culture, seeking to read the language of the Quran as a language of human relations. Bishop Odo has suggested that one of the greatest challenges faced by Eastern Christianity and the religious discourses in the Arab and Muslim world revolves around the creation of an intellectual freedom to explore the text, for example, the comparative reading between the biblical and the Quranic accounts, such as the story of Joseph in Genesis and the same account in Surah 12 in the Quran. This endeavor, he states, may contribute to finding points of similarity and divergence, with a view of interrogating each text on the subject of the theological basis, moving from the example of narration of the texts, contribute to understanding of its sensitivities and a vision of God and man, divine-human relations being central to the question of Christology. Malfono Antoine stands in a direct line beginning with the Eastern Church Fathers of the Syriac world, Isaac of Nineveh and John of Daliatha, to our present era as a modern church father reading the signs of our times for our day. Vice Chancellor, I request you, on the authority of the Governing Board of Heythrop College, to admit Bishop Dr. Antoine Odo, S.J., to the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, Doctor of Divinity, Cursus Honoris Causas.
Vice Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Professor Francis Xavier Clooney, Parkman Professor of Divinity at Harvard University. Frank is a Jesuit priest, a scholar of the Sanskrit and Tamil traditions of Hindu India, and one of the most prolific and imaginative theologians working in interreligious relations today. Few theologians can claim to have inspired a new school of theology. Not that Frank would make a lot of noise about that claim. He may hail from New York, but not all citizens of the Big Apple feel that they have to brag about their achievements. It would, however, be fair to think of him as a sort of theological godfather, a very gentle godfather. After completing his doctorate at the University of Chicago in 1984, Frank began teaching at Boston College, and I first met him there in 1992 and was immediately struck by the brilliant simplicity of his method. He got his students to read a Christian religious text alongside a Hindu religious text, to read them together. That is comparative theology, a practice of interreligious learning in which texts on similar themes are allowed to speak to each other and thus enhance theological understanding. Vice Chancellor, it is so simple and so engaging that I've even managed it myself. Indeed, I was delighted a few years back to read in an article that Michael Barnes does comparative theology. A great compliment. But Frank is in a different league. He has written 18 books of erudite reflection on the Hindu-Christian interface, all based on the Jesuit conviction that God is to be found in all things, including the sincerely held beliefs and practices of other people of faith. Now, although new in its present form, comparative theology has many remote antecedents in the Catholic tradition. Frank is part of the great Jesuit tradition and could be traced right back to the 17th century Jesuit missionary in India, Roberto de Noboli, who lived and dressed in the style of a sannyasi, a Hindu holy man, and engaged in serious dialogue with local Brahmins, convinced that in classical Hinduism were to be found echoes and resonances of Christian faith. Now, as far as I know, Frank does not, at least yet, wander around Harvard Yard clothed in saffron robes. On the other hand, his scholarly understanding of Hindu wisdom has made him a welcome guest, both in academic circles and in temples and Hindu centers throughout the world. His is an impressive witness to the call of Vatican II that Christians not only respect other religions, but, in the words of Nostra Aetate, recognize, preserve, and promote their spiritual values. Vice Chancellor, I request you, on the authority of the governing body of Heythrop College, to admit Professor Francis Clooney to the degree of Doctor of Divinity, honoris causa.
Vice Chancellor, colleagues, graduates, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure and privilege to introduce to you the Reverend Canon Professor Sarah Coakley. Sarah is a Norris Hulse Professor of Divinity at the University of Cambridge, Professorial Fellow of Murray Edwards College, Cambridge, her alma mater, and Honorary Canon of Ely Cathedral. Sarah was raised an Anglo-Catholic Anglican in South London, began to wonder whether a woman could be a theologian at the age of 12, and spent much of her adolescence reading the thinkers who would help to shape her intellectual and spiritual vision. Evelyn Underhill on mystical theology, Simone Weil on attention, the local bishop John Robinson on being honest to God. She was later taught by Robinson at Cambridge, appreciating his willingness, quotes, to let students teach themselves and to explicate, if they wished, a fearlessly radical approach. At the same time, she developed a burgeoning admiration for analytic philosophy of religion, with its, quotes, willingness to face hard philosophical questions with incisive clarity. Put together, we have the ingredients which have eventually yielded a systematic theology in which art, philosophy, anthropology, spirituality, mysticism, and gender theory are radically and fruitfully intertwined. This is Sarah's most recent and ongoing project, entitled On Desiring God, and it poses a decisive challenge to those for whom theology has become a dead and irrelevant discipline, being one of the most exciting and important movements in contemporary theology and philosophy of religion. We might call it an exercise in recentering, one which depicts God at the frontier of human existence and theology as its systematic and all-encompassing backdrop. Sarah's fearlessly radical approach is expressed in numerous articles, monographs, and her Gifford Lectures series of 2012. She's been a huge influence on my own thinking, as well as a dear friend, and her research on desire has been key to the recent work of our Centre for Philosophy of Religion. Sarah's also been a great support to the college as a whole, particularly when it became clear that our existence was under threat. As she said in her letter to the Times, orchestrated on our behalf, quote, Heythrop is not an institution which can be replaced by anything equal or equivalent to it. Its closure will be a serious blow to theological, religious, and philosophical teaching and research in this country. Vice Chancellor, I request you on the authority of the governing body of Heythrop College to admit Professor Sarah Coakley to the degree of Doctor of Divinity, honoris causa.
Vice-Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, I present to you His Excellency the Most Reverend Michael Fitzgerald of the Missionaries of Africa, titular Archbishop of Nepte. Nepte, you ask. This is where Wikipedia comes into its own. Nepte is an ancient Christian see in the middle of modern Tunisia, and it's an important historical center, I discover, of Sufism, the mystical side of Islam. And Tunisia is where Archbishop Michael studied theology and where his lifelong commitment to dialogue with and understanding of Islam was nurtured. It's within this sphere of Muslim-Christian relations that Archbishop Michael has made such an enormous contribution to the life of the Catholic Church and beyond that, to the common good. It's that contribution we honor today. After doctoral studies at the Pontifical Gregorian University during the period of the Second Vatican Council, then in Arabic at the School of Oriental and African Studies here in the University of London, he worked as a missionary priest in Sudan and taught Arabic at the Pontifical Institute for Arabic and Islamic Studies in Rome. In 1987, he was appointed Secretary of what is now the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue. Ordained bishop by Pope John Paul II in 1992, he became president of the council in 2002. Between 2006 and 2012, he was papal nuncio to Egypt and delegate to the League of Arab States. Vice Chancellor, he may have retired, but Archbishop Michael shows no signs of slowing down. He's a regular lecturer on Muslim-Christian relations at conferences and meetings throughout the world. Each address and his books and articles are all rooted in the spirit of the Second Vatican Council, especially in the generosity it commends towards people of different faiths. Archbishop Michael demonstrates in his every word and action how the desire to learn from the other can be made compatible with a respectful expression of one's own deepest convictions. Not that he limits his sphere of interest to Islam. Once a few years ago, I remember he chaired a forum of somewhat anarchic Catholic Buddhist specialists who had been called together to advise the Vatican on the state of Buddhist-Christian relations in Europe. I had the misfortune to be chosen as secretary. We managed to pull together a workmanlike text, but there were a few dodgy moments when I was grateful for Archbishop Michael's wisdom and experience. I like to think that dialogue happens when persons meet, and that is no doubt true, but it always helps to have the odd learned archbishop around who can give firm but gentle oversight to proceedings. Vice Chancellor, I request you on the authority of the governing body of Heythrop College to admit Archbishop Michael Fitzgerald to the degree of Doctor of Divinity, honoris causa.
Vice-Chancellor, colleagues, graduates, ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Reverend Dr. Vreg Nersessian. Father Nersessian is one of the most distinguished scholars of the Armenian Christian tradition. The breadth of his knowledge and understanding covers the entire history of the Armenian Church. In 2013, Father Nersessian gave a series of magisterial lectures at the Centre for Eastern Christianity at Heythrop College, University of London. During 5 evenings, he surveyed the history of the Armenian Christianity from the 4th to the 20th century to a mesmerised audience. On learning of this endeavour, Kerakhen II, Supreme Patriarch of Catholicus of all the Armenians, wrote, "We convey our blessings and appreciation to you from the Mother See of Holy Echmiadzin, for your intent to raise public awareness regarding the Armenian Apostolic Church, her role and significance in the Christian East." Father Nersessian was born in Tehran in 1948. He was educated at the Armenian College in Calcutta, the newly independent India, at the Kevorkian Theological Academy in the Holy Echmiadzin, Armenia, and at King's College of the University of London. His doctoral thesis, the Tongrekian movement, religious movements in the Armenian Church from the 4th to the 5th centuries, was published in 1987. After graduation in 1975, he joined the British Library as the curator responsible for the manuscripts and printed books of the Eastern Christians of the Middle East, a post which he held until his retirement in August 2011. He was ordained a priest in 1983, elevated to the rank of archpriest in 1991 by Catholicus Vatsin I. He looked after and served the Armenian Church in London and throughout the United Kingdom. Among his British Library publications are the catalogue of early Armenian printed books, a history of Armenian printing up until 1850, Armenian illuminated gospel books, the treasures of the Ark, 1700 years of Armenian Christian art, a catalogue of the exhibition of the same by the same name held at the British Library to mark the 700th anniversary of the conversion of Armenia to Christianity, the Bible in the Armenian tradition in 2001, is most recently a catalogue of the Armenian manuscripts in the British Library acquired since the year 1913, and the collections in their other libraries in the United Kingdom, published in 2012. Described as a fitting culmination to a long and distinguished career. Father Nersessian scholarship has brought the Armenian Christian tradition into ecumenical conversation with the Catholic tradition. His most recent article he published in One in Christ, a Catholic ecumenical review, concerns Gregory of Nyrek, mystic and poet, the soul's search for immediacy with God. Gregory of Nyrek's works are found in every Armenian home, this great medieval theologian and spiritual writer. In April 2015, Gregory of Nyrek was proclaimed a Doctor of the Catholic Church by Pope Francis at the Vatican in the presence of all the Armenian Orthodox Catholicist leaders, including the Armenian Catholic Patriarch. Those church leaders have declared their commitment to dialogue and unity. Pope Francis, with astonishing clarity, stated in May 2015, "The Armenian Apostolic Church has had to become a pilgrim people. It has experienced in a singular way what it means to journey towards the kingdom of God. The history of immigration, persecutions, and martyrdom experienced by so many of the faithful has inflicted deep wounds on the hearts of all Armenians. We must see and venerate those wounds as inflicted upon the very body of Christ. And for this very reason, a cause of unfailing hope and trust in the provident mercy of the Father." Father Nersessian's work has highlighted the suffering of the Armenian Church during the period of genocide, which consumed an estimated 1.5 million Armenian Christians between 1915 and 1922, including 4,000 clergy. Between 1915 and 1923, thousands of churches, monasteries and libraries were destroyed, and it took many decades for the Armenian Church to recover. Pope Francis reminds us, "It is the responsibility not only of the Armenian people and the Universal Church to recall that all has taken place, but for the whole entire human family, so that warnings from this tragedy will protect us from falling into a similar horror, which offends God and human dignity. Today, too, in fact, these conflicts at times degenerate into unjustifiable violence, stirred by the exploiting of ethnic and religious differences. Only reconciliation gives meaning to the martyrdom of so many." Father Nersessian is not only a great scholar, his work is a mirror in which the ancient beauty of the Armenian tradition is reflected into our world as a profound enrichment and witness. Vice Chancellor, I request you, on the authority of the Governing Board of Heythrop College, to admit Reverend Dr. Nersessian to the degree of the Doctor of Divinity, honoris causa.
Vice-Chancellor, colleagues, new graduates. It is, of course, a very particular honour for me to be invited to respond on behalf of all us honorands today and to express our deep gratitude to you at Heythrop for the gracious words spoken about our work and for the degrees you have bestowed on us this afternoon. Perhaps more importantly, however, today is a bittersweet moment when all of us must both rejoice afresh in the historic witness of Heythrop as a Jesuit institution, but also reflect with sadness on the irreplaceable role that Heythrop has, since 1970, played in the educational and spiritual climate of London and of this country, but will shortly do no longer.
The particular combination of philosophy, theology, and spirituality, historically combined in Ignatian formation, but spread creatively throughout the degree curriculum here. The gracious and fearless engagement with non-Christian religious traditions, yet without any repression of the robustly theological voice. The commitment to the poor and oppressed. The extraordinary ecumenical openness and generosity of spirit, from which my own Anglican Church in particular, and other Protestant churches and groups too, have benefited at least as much as the Roman Catholic, the Orthodox, and the non-Chalcedonian and Uniate churches of the East. And the creative support of women and men from so many diverse backgrounds, as we have seen this afternoon, ages and cultures, lay, religious and ordained, these have been and are the special hallmarks of Heythrop, and you graduates too bear witness to them fully. In offering thanks then for the honorary degrees that have been bestowed on us today, I more especially offer thanks from us all to this college for its historic Christian witness, its exemplary teaching and scholarship, and for the ineradicable spiritual marks that I know it has left on all who have been formed here. The culture of British theological scholarship without Heythrop still seems almost unthinkable to me and to many others. But one can take comfort in the thought that you, today's graduates, as well as the teachers who have formed you, will continue to leave your scholarly impress wherever you find yourselves. It is then with this mixture of joy and sadness that I offer special gratitude for what Heythrop has done for us honorands today and has meant to us all over the years. Thank you.
Vice-Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, it is my great honour and privilege to propose the vote of thanks to all concerned who have been involved in today's ceremony. My thanks to Professor Sir Adrian Smith, the Vice-Chancellor of the University of London, for again presenting our awards today, and for his words of wisdom and insight commentary on the world of higher education. I would also like to say a thank you, both on a personal level and on behalf of the College, to Professor Claire Ozanne, who has picked up the reins so beautifully and competently as the principal of the College since January. Once again, the ceremony and events of today have been quite beautifully organised and have gone seamlessly without a hitch. This is due to Annabel Clarkson and her team, and Bindi Ray, Head of External Relations, Media and PR, and her team at the University of London. To them all, many thanks. Commentary has been made today of the staff at Heythrop. Huge votes of thanks are due to them all. They continue to exceed even their own high standards. Thank you. Very many congratulations to all of you graduating today. The achievements that we have heard recited are a great testament to each individual, as well as those who have supported you both at home and at the college. Congratulations, and may each of you be forever proud to be a graduate of Heythrop. My thanks and congratulations to those accepting our honorary fellowships and doctorates today. The honor is really ours in your acceptance of them. One of the things that continues to strike me at Heythrop is the generosity of spirit from all those involved, both within the college at Kensington Square and in the wider community. The willingness to go the extra mile to help everyone. I was reminded of this in a letter that I came across recently, although I'm pleased to say that those at Heythrop tend to be rather more effective than the writer of this letter. It's about an English lady who wanted to buy a holiday home in a small village in the mountains of Bavaria. Knowing no German, she asked the estate agent to help her. She therefore wrote to him to get full particulars. And she asked in her letter whether there was a WC attached to the property, as she had forgotten to inquire previously. The estate agent didn't know the abbreviation WC, so he consulted the local priest, who also knew a little English. They came to the conclusion that the lady, known to be a devout churchgoer, wanted to know the location of the wayside chapel. The agent wrote the following by way of a helpful reply. Dear madam, the WC is situated about 7 miles from your property, in the centre of the pine forest, amidst lovely scenery, and is open on Tuesdays and Sundays. This is unfortunate if you are in the habit of going regularly. But no doubt you will be pleased to hear that some people take their lunch with them and make a day of it. As there are a great many visitors in the summer, it would be advisable to you to go early. There are about 60 seats, but should you at any time be late, there is ample standing room. A bell will be rung about 10 minutes before the WC is opened. I would advise you to pay a visit on a Tuesday, as on that day there is an organ accompaniment. The acoustics of the premises are excellent. Even the most delicate sound can be heard all over the building. I shall be delighted to reserve a seat for you in order to have the pleasure of sitting next to you. Hoping to hear from you soon, yours, etc. P.S. My wife and I have been meaning to go for the past 8 months, but it is a long way off, which pains me very much. Vice-Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, I shall keep you straining no longer. That concludes the proceedings for today. I now formally close the 2017 graduation ceremony for Heythrop College and invite you all to join this reception and to celebrate your success.